Anyway, lots of stories, but Neil's gone on since SETI Express days and is now in charge of the ESA Parabolic flight campaigns, and no doubt he's going to be telling you more about that and some of the other spacey projects that he's involved with. So, Neil, over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, now for something completely different.
What do you get if you take 40 experimenters, they're 12 experiments, put them in an aircraft, accelerate at maximum thrust, 50 degrees up into the air, and then let go? You get zero gravity science, and that's exactly what we're doing here on the European Space Agency's 72nd parabolic flight campaign. My name's Neil Melville, and I'm floating all the way up there.
Right, so you've already had a brief introduction from Graham, thank you very much. So I'm Neil Melville, and my interest and passion for space started quite a while ago. I think about age four, this is my grandfather encouraging me and wearing some kind of sci-fi t-shirt. And then a few things happened over the next 20 years or so, and then as Graham mentioned, my first contact with AMSAT, which is obviously, you know, a milestone event in my life, was on the SETI Express mission, and here I am with Graham in Plesetsk, watching SETI Express get lifted up on the top of the Cosmos 3M rocket in the background. It was a fantastic project. After that, I also worked on the GENSO network, a kind of a prototype ground station collaboration network. Some of you may remember. We never quite finished it, but I'm glad to see some aspects of it still float around, which is quite nice. But since 2002, I've worked for the European Space Agency, mostly as a system engineer. Here I am with about the same amount of hair, but differently distributed. This is my first ever payload on a Russian Photon M1 rocket, which was, again, a fantastic experience. That's where I really learned the beginning of payload systems engineering. Systems engineering being the high-level technical management, so there'll be structural engineers and thermal and software and radio engineers reporting to me with their individual tasks. From the system engineering point of view, I'm the one that's got to collect it all together so that we make something overall that works and fulfills the objectives. But alongside that, since 2016, I've been coordinating ESA's parabolic flights, which is mostly what I'm going to be telling you about today. A little bit more context. So this is I work in ESA's human and robotic exploration program. And they do all sorts of exciting things. You've probably heard about Gateway, and you probably heard about the European service module on the back of Orion that's sitting on not on the launch pad right now, but on Artemis SLS mission, going to launch soon. You probably heard about our activities on Mars. But I don't really work very much on that. Most of my work is this little blue line over here. If you can't see it, there it is. I work on that kind of suborbital stuff mostly. The program is called SciSpace. It's part of the newly named Terra Nova program. The objectives are understanding how space, fundamental physics and biological processes are affected by space, and finding ways to explore and live sustainably whilst bringing benefits back to Earth. That's the overarching objectives of SciSpace. We have a load of different platforms we do that on. Of course, we have the Columbus module on the ISS. We have sounding rockets. We have parabolic flights. We have drop tower. We even have human centrifuges. And the overarching kind of concept that binds these things together is microgravity. I know you might say, how on Earth can you get microgravity on a centrifuge? And you'd be right, you can't. But we're using the centrifuges to investigate the countermeasures. So we take human test subjects, put them in bed for 2 months, which sounds like fun until you learn you've got to be 6 degrees head down and you're not allowed to sit up or stand up at all, because this simulates being in long duration microgravity. And then we put them on a centrifuge and make them exercise to try to simulate what we could do on orbit later as countermeasures to deal with the muscle wastage and bone wastage. So microgravity is really the thread that binds all of this together. Or zero gravity. You'll hear the two terms kind of interchangeably. Microgravity is when you're being specific about how little it is, and zero is like the intention of what we're intending. So I'll use them kind of interchangeably. Everyone thinks they know what zero G is, what weightlessness is. I'm sure you all do, and you're probably all pretty much right. But it's the kind of thing you hear quite a lot of discussions about and get quite heated over some pints at the end of the evening when people realise they actually didn't understand quite the same thing. So I'm going to tell you a little bit just to make sure we're on the same page. So this is Paxi, the anthropomorphic ESA alien mascot. We usually use him for kids, but why not? Let's have him here today. He's a very friendly little chap. I've given him a handheld radio, even though he doesn't have any hands. I don't really know how he's gonna work with that. The simplest way to be in really zero gravity, to be so far away from any large objects that gravity is literally zero. There is almost no gravitational field. So here Paxi is floating with his little handheld a long way from absolutely anything. We also notice his spacesuit is an absolutely terrible design. If that does have a visor, it doesn't really matter because bits of him are outside anyway. Let's give him a spaceship to be in. So now he's quite happy. He can hang around there as much as he likes. But that's not really what we do, is it? Humans have never been far away from everything. Humans are very close to Earth. The furthest we've ever been is just past the Moon, and most of the time we don't even get past low Earth orbit. Dirty, great big planets have a lot of gravity. So why do we say that we're in zero gravity? Orbits need gravity, so why do we say we're in zero gravity or weightless? Well, to be technically correct, which is the best kind of correct, the ISO definition of weight is F equals mg, where the little g is the local acceleration due to free fall. And that's the key, local. So in the frame of reference of the planet, gravity is not zero, but in the frame of reference of Pax's little spacecraft, gravity is zero. That small g is gravity, that is zero. The definition of weight uses that small g, so he is weightless. As long as he is free to fall, then the gravity field outside is completely irrelevant. Whatever it is, as long as he and his ship and his little handheld are free to fall, then the whole time they are free to fall, as he is doing now, he will be weightless. Of course, if you don't take care and do something different, then you're not free to fall for very long, and then Paxi hurts himself, he's broken his radio, he's impaled himself with an antenna, he's not a happy chap. We want to avoid that. How do we avoid that? Well, let's put him back up there. We can use some engines. If you use some engines, some form of propulsion. Now, the problem is he's not falling to his doom, but he's also not in zero G because we're accelerating. He's pushed to the back of the spacecraft. His radio is sitting at his feet. He's standing there quite happily. But that's only during the acceleration phase, because acceleration and gravity, in the end, Einstein told us, are actually the same thing. Once he stops accelerating and he's going at a constant velocity sideways, if he gets that velocity right, then he keeps falling. Just as he did before, he is free to fall, but if he gets the velocity right, he falls all the way around and just keeps going. He never hits the planet. Orbits are falling, but you're just going so fast sideways that you keep missing. That's the whole idea of an orbit. So that's why we call it zero G, because in his frame of reference, there is no gravity, even though if there were no gravity for our frame of reference, he'd go sailing off into the distance and we'd never see him or hear from his handheld ever again. So, bringing it to a more familiar, real-life situation. The International Space Station is, of course, doing this. The altitude is only 408 kilometres. Some of us have travelled further than that to be here. It's not very far away. Velocity is very fast, 7.66 kilometres a second or so. For those that prefer these things in old units, that's just over 2,000 furlongs, about 46 furlongs per microfortnight. That works out to 14 orbits per day. The ISS has continually had crew on board since the 2nd November 2000. I think that's amazing. We're coming up on 22 years during which not all of humanity has been on Earth. For the last 22 years, some of humanity has always been somewhere else. I think that's amazing. It's a fantastic platform for living, working, researching in space. ESA has many experiments on the Columbus Laboratory and a couple of other places. A typical microgravity level on board is about a thousandth of a G. But it varies a lot because you get docking and undocking, you get orbit raising, you get astronauts bumping into things and exercising, you do all sorts of inconsiderate stuff like that. But it's pretty good, it's a fantastic platform. Then if we go even lower, an orbit which intersects the planet is a suborbit. And it's important to remember here that if the planet were the same mass but smaller, it wouldn't intersect. It would just be a normal orbit, right? You keep going around. As long as the craft on that line is free to fall, then everything inside it will be in zero gravity until that intersection. So far, it's been mostly used for missiles and stuff, but also for space tourism. I'm sure you've heard Virgin Galactic, Blue Origin. This is what they do for very wealthy or lucky individuals. Can go and spend a few minutes, 4 or 5 minutes, in a suborbital trajectory to enjoy that zero G inside their frame of reference. The media tends to misrepresent this as being this amazing new space race and equating it with all of this orbital tourism. It's really quite different. It's not even really like this suborbit. Let me put it to scale for you. There it is, just there. I think you'll agree once you appreciate that scale that really it's impressive. It's good. I don't want to say that it's not a good thing. I like that the capability exists and is growing, but the media is very bad at not explaining the difference between that and orbital stuff, or orbital capability. SpaceX is planning to do stuff like this much larger suborbit with their Starship launcher, which should be orbit capable, but they want to do point-to-point as well. Let's see if that ever works out. I'm sure there'll be a few more entertaining explosions on the way before they do that. ESA also uses suborbits. So we have a sounding rocket program. The altitude's about 750 kilometers, so nearly twice as high as the ISS, but you're only up there for 30 minutes because you don't have this fantastic sideways velocity, which means the rocket can be much smaller. The payload's around 600 kilograms. Here's one of the biggest payloads we've worked on. There I am with the rest of the team. We've got four experiments or so on board there. It launches from ESA range in Kiruna. There's the launch. This is Maxus 9. The microgravity on board there is extremely close to zero. It's very good, 10 to the minus 6. It's probably the best we can get of any of our platforms. So the experimenters are very happy with that. And of course, the environment allows us to put dangerous stuff on there that you wouldn't be able to fly on the ISS or on parabolic flights, like things that are very hot, toxic chemicals, powerful X-rays, this kind of stuff. And you get it back. It comes back by parachute and lands in the Arctic tundra in northern Sweden, and we go pick it up by helicopter. It's a very weird day after years and years of work when this thing flies in the morning, you've been up all night waiting for it, and then you go and have lunch, and then it comes back and you can hold a piece of hardware that's been in space today. It's a very weird experience to have, but it's great fun to work on. But what about an even smaller and lower suborbit? So here's a highly elliptical suborbit I would like you to consider. The apogee is only 8,700 meters above sea level. The lowest velocity at the top of this would be about 220 kilometers an hour. The other end, remember, if the Earth was the same mass but really small, the other end would be very close to the center and a considerable fraction of the speed of light. But let's not worry about that for now. We only want to look at the top bit, because that upper 500 meters or so, that's flyable by an aircraft. And this red line is actual flight data from one of our parabolic flights. That is what ESA parabolic flights are. You're taking an aircraft and purposely injecting it into a tiny little segment of a suborbit. And that means this is not a simulation. We're not simulating zero G. That's the same zero G as you're getting on the space station, as they're getting on Virgin Galactic, or Blue Origin, etc., etc. It's a real suborbit. The only difference is it's in some air. And we're using the engines to counteract the air drag. Here's some more real data. The yellow line is the G level. So you can see beforehand, we're at around 1G. During this pull-up phase, we get about 1.8G. And then during this little suborbit, we drop down to almost zero G, plus or minus a percent or two. And then, of course, we want to recover the aircraft and pull out, and we get the 1.8G again. So it takes about a minute, and you go back to normal flight. So just to explain that from the plane's point of view, so a normal steady flight, of course, we have the four force vectors. Weight and lift in steady flight are the same, so you're not going up or down, you're just cruising along, because thrust and drag are also cancelling each other out, so you go constant velocity. Then for a parabola, you accelerate, you increase your thrust, and you add a lot of lift, so the plane's going up, so we'll feel like we're being pushed down. So you weigh 1.8G, 80% extra of your body weight, which matters more to some of us than to others. And then once you're 50 degrees nose up into the air, and this is an Airbus A310, this is not a small aircraft, they call in injection, and then cancel the thrust just so it cancels out the drag, and nose down a little bit to remove any lift. And then because thrust and drag are cancelled, we only have our weight to worry about, so we're exactly in one of these sub-orbits. One of the interesting points here, of course, as you know, if you've ever taken off in a plane, which I'm sure we all have, when a plane is travelling, facing the exact direction it's travelling, you get lift. So actually you need to be nose slightly down compared to your direction of travel, so that the wings don't generate any lift. And our direction of travel is a parabola. It's easiest to see here at the very top, the plane is traveling horizontally, but it has to be slightly nose down so the wings are not doing anything. Also, I don't really tend to tell people this before they've flown because they get a bit nervous, but at only 120 knots or so at the very top, they're below the stall speed of the plane. It couldn't fly if it wanted to. But that's okay, we don't want to. We want to fall until we've got enough speed to start flying again. And that's what we do. We end up 42 degrees nose down. We have our own airspace to do this because other aircraft might be a little bit disturbed to see us fly past like this. And at 42 degrees nose down, we pull out. So you put the lift back, you let the air drag slow you down, and you recover back to steady flight. So that's one parabola, and that takes about a minute, 20 seconds of hyper-G, 20 seconds of zero-G, 20 seconds of hyper-G. And we do that every 3 minutes for 2 hours. So here's a view from outside the window, from outside the plane, inside the cockpit, and out the front of the cockpit. So you can see this pilot closest to us is only doing the roll. He has a couple of little bands attached to the stick so that he can adjust the roll without having to fight the guy that's doing the pitch. This other pilot's doing the pitch, and he's got a fixed stick attached to his so that he doesn't have to fight the guy doing the roll. So you've decoupled those two axes. The chap in the middle, sitting in the back flight seat, he's leaning through and doing the throttle to exactly cancel the drag. And it's only by having three pilots doing this simultaneously that you can get the precision. If you tried to do it with one pilot, you'd never be able to control all three axes with enough precision. You hear the alarms going off. That's because you can't adjust the software of an Airbus A310 without needing to re-qualify it for flight, which would be millions and millions and thousands of flight hours. So you leave the software, but this plane is old enough that it's not a proper fly-by-wire. You still have a real control over your flight surfaces, but the computer still complains at you. So you have to just decide which alarms to ignore because it thinks you're not doing something very sensible. It might have a point, I suppose. Let's watch that one more time. So you can see the kind of slightly crazy looking angles. It's worth noting also that in this 2G phase, of course everything is in 2G, including the plane. It's like it's carrying another copy of itself. The wings bend quite a lot on the way out. I also don't tend to tell people that before they've flown. It does make them nervous. And it's important to note, because a lot of people get it wrong, you're in zero G on the way up as well. So they're already in zero G whilst they're falling up and over. It's from the point of letting go until the point of recovery. You can see how focused these guys are. Of course, they're experiencing this 2G and this zero G. They're the red stuff. They're usually French test pilots. Sometimes we have Thomas Pesquet, the French astronaut, that comes and flies for us. And you can also only do this job, especially the pitch, that's the hard one. You can only do that for 5 or 10 parabolas before your concentration slips and you're not so precise anymore. So the guy on the pitch will go take a break, the other two rotate into position, and we'll have a fourth pilot on board that comes back from his break and takes over, and they cycle through. Because we don't just do this once on every flight, we do it every 3 minutes for 2 hours. So yeah, we have 31 parabolas on each flight. This is in the back looking at all the experiments. As you can see, we don't have any windows in the experiment area, so we're not disturbed by all of this crazy horizon shifts outside. We just feel 1G or 2G or no G. In total, that's about 10 minutes of zero G in a flight, which is about twice as long as Virgin Galactic or Blue Origin. Not that I'm keeping score. Each campaign that we do has three flights on three consecutive days, so you're getting about half an hour in total for each of these experiments. And ESA run two or three campaigns, but I say ESA, it's me. I run two or three campaigns per year. But the plane doesn't belong to ESA, the plane belongs to Nova Space. It's a private company, it's a subsidiary of Kness, but it is private. They operate it, they're fantastic. They've been doing this for nearly three decades now. Scientists from any ESA member state can apply with proposals to come on board. selected on scientific merit. We get the best ones, we invite them to come along. It takes about 6 months to get ready from the point of invitation. Then we work with the teams for about 6 months to get their experiments ready, because they've usually got some huge setup in the lab that they'd like to use. That of course has to be miniaturized, but most of all has to be made safe, because the longer we're working with high pressures, with high temperatures, with mechanisms, with x-rays, with toxic chemicals, etc., stuff that you wouldn't normally take on an airplane, certainly stuff you wouldn't get through airport security. So we have to do a lot of work to make sure it's safe. So it's about 6 months prep time, and then we go to Bordeaux, where Nova Space is based, for 2 weeks. The first week is the hardware arriving, incoming inspections and checks and approvals. Then we load it all onto the aircraft, interference checks, make sure the system all works together, safety verifications. It all takes quite a long time. And then the second week is 3 consecutive flight days with some backup time. I have about 12 experiments on board each time, more or less, and we can take up to 40 passengers, and that's the engineers and the scientists. There's also crew, of course. I'll send that going again while I talk more. Part of this hands-on aspect is really important, because of course we've got all those other platforms, the ISS and sounding rockets and stuff, but there you have to further miniaturize your equipment, and you're operating it by remote, or you're not operating it at all. Like, the astronauts do a great job for us on the station, of course, but they're not the scientists that designed the hardware. They can't make scientific decisions on the fly. They can't adjust their parameters on the fly. On here, because you're with your own hardware that you've designed and built yourself, you can really adjust stuff. And you've got this high repetition rate. So in between parabolas, there are some breaks. It's not always just a couple of minutes. There are some breaks, so you can retune things, you can change samples, you can try to fix it if it's broken. Human test subjects can be swapped, because we're doing some human physiology, and they can be swapped between the flights as well. So there's really a lot of flexibility on board this platform. We have student experiments as well, not only professionals. Students can apply through the ESA Academy Fly Your Thesis program, which I should update this slide because I've just changed the name, but I've forgotten what it's called now, but I'm sure you can find it. And in the near future, we plan to add technological and commercial application routes, which I can tell you a little bit more about later. I should also point out we can do partial gravity. It's a familiar picture now. If you just keep a little bit of lift, we can have gravity anywhere between 0 and 1, which is quite useful. The accuracy is around 1 or 2%, just as it is in the 0G case. This is me demonstrating this with one of my daughter's stuffed toys. This was kind of a video for her, but it worked out quite well, so I kept it. These look like I've just changed the speeds. I haven't. These are all filmed in real time. There's lunar gravity on the top left, Martian gravity on the top right, normal Earth gravity you're quite familiar with, and this is double gravity. It's quite hard to throw and catch stuff in 2G, actually. And it's important to note that this is quite unique, really, because if you want to experience lunar gravity, you've got a choice. You can either go to the moon or you can come on this plane, and it's the only way of doing it. There are other parabolic planes in the world, only a few, but this is the only one that's flown in the right way that they can manage to offer these kind of partial gravity levels. Scientists really like it. You can fill in the graph. They've got data at 0G, they've got data at 1G. Maybe they want it by tenths, or maybe they want it by quarters, or they're looking for where their 0G regime of the phenomena switches into the 1G regime, trying to find the threshold level. And of course, we use it for testing lunar hardware or Martian hardware, which is starting to come through now with the new programs. As I say, it's a unique capability of the Nova Space A310 0G. I'm particularly fond of Martian gravity, 0.38 g. I'm quite comfortable at 0.38 g. I think I could handle that for a long time. To zoom down even more, an even smaller sub-orbit, if you like, but really quite small, I'm also responsible for coordinating ESA activity on the Zarm drop tower. It's a 146-meter tower in Bremen in Germany. If you drop stuff from the top, you get about 4.5 seconds. If you fire from a catapult at the bottom, you get about 9 seconds. Of course, we've taken all the air out inside, so you've not got any air drag. And that's the reason that you can only get 2 or 3 flights a day, because it takes quite a while to pump that big volume down. This is typical size of capsules. It's quite a big experiment you can put on there. It's quite a robust platform that they recycle, they use for all the different payloads. And they've got nice labs in Zaum where they'll help you set all sorts of stuff up. They'll lend you equipment. Here's a little video of a catapult launch. Capsule heading up the tower and almost reaching the top, but not quite. Falls back down again into this massive bucket of polystyrene balls. It's very, very high tech. That's about a 30G shock at the end. So then, of course, they've got to let all the air back in so that they can open the door, go and fish the thing out of the bucket of polystyrene balls, hoover up all the polystyrene balls and put them back in the bucket. This is just to show that PAXI does get around. Here's a student experiment. Apparently, after all, he's fine being in a vacuum in that spacesuit. He didn't seem to suffer any ill effects. Turned a bit green. Zaum have also just put a new facility on. It's kind of a prototype. So it's not the whole tower, this one, just the base here. And they put just a 16-meter, much smaller tower on there. And here you only get 2.5 seconds flight time. So you might ask, well, what's the point of that? And the microgravity is not so good. It's only 10 to the minus 4 instead of 10 to the minus 6, which is still great, but it's not so good. So why are they doing that? The point is it's a capsule in a capsule system on a rail, like a roller coaster almost. Which means that they don't have to have a vacuum, they don't have to suck all the air out, and it can just go up and down all day. They reckon they can get it up to about 800 flights a day. So if your phenomenon that you're studying fits within 2.5 seconds, you can have 800 flights a day, which is a huge amount of data. Not that many phenomena do, but a lot of teams are starting to use it for the first half day or day of their campaign. They want to test that their equipment works properly. They want to get all the triggers set up for zero G. They want to narrow their parameter space to make sure they're exploring the right part of the parameter space. And then they'll move to the big tower to do the real drops once they've got that right. So it's a really useful facility. They're hoping to scale this up to the whole size, but that would be many millions of euros and years to do. If so, they'd also be able to offer partial G, because it's a computer-controlled system, which would be quite nice. Right, so why do we do all of this, you might quite rightly ask. Well, as I said, it's all for science. It's scientific research, in the end, is what we're really trying to do. And so I'm just going to give you an overview of a few experiments. I'm not going to delve into huge amounts of detail, because there's too much to cover. But you can ask me later. This is an example, this experiment called Plasma Crystal 4. Which is actually also an experiment that flies on the International Space Station, but we use parabolic flights again to narrow the parameter space to get everything working properly before we spend millions to send it up there. They're playing with plasmas. I shouldn't say playing, should I? They're controlling plasmas using lasers and electric fields, trying to understand how you can move plasmas around. It's quite hard to see when you move plasma, so they inject dust into it, which they form into a nice kind of static zero-G lattice, and then push that around. And this will be useful in any kind of plasma control stuff, so for propulsion in zero-G, maybe for fusion research, this kind of stuff. We have some real fringe theoretical, physics research. Quantum gravity, as you may know, quantum mechanics and general relativity don't play very nicely together, but around zero G you can do some interesting research. So a quag pit searching for relativistic effects on quantum entanglement once you get to low gravity regime, and QWEP is testing the equivalence principle on the quantum level, and the equivalence principle is most well known by the hammer and feather drop experiment from Apollo, that everything falls at the same rate, all gravitational fields are equivalent. But also the equivalence principle is telling us that gravity and acceleration are the same thing, which was my point in the first few slides, and why we can do parabolic flights for zero G at all. We do some experiments that are looking towards exploration. This is a test mechanism for asteroid sampling. So I'm sure you've seen some of these fantastic missions we've had recently with like bullets being fired into asteroids and collecting debris, and the DART mission wasn't trying to take samples, but they're all quite violent. This is looking for a soft approach of trying to scoop up material without pushing yourself off of the asteroid, which is one of the major problems. This payload is looking at Martian dust storms, because it's not very well understood how the very, very thin atmosphere of Mars manages to pick up such huge quantities of dust. So we're looking at dust pickup here in rarefied atmospheres. And actually, of course, to have a Martian gravity campaign, you'd need everyone to want Martian gravity and fill the whole plane. That doesn't always the case. They flew this on a zero-G campaign, but they made a Martian centrifuge to simulate Martian gravity. It's quite good. I don't know why I've got a picture of it there, because I've got a video of it here. So that's a Martian centrifuge in zero gravity. Why? why not? Because, of course, a Martian centrifuge in Earth gravity isn't going to work. It worked extremely well. They've actually adapted it for more Martian experiments using that same platform for the future. Also, of course, carrying raw materials up into space is very expensive. So the idea for long-term space exploration is in-situ resource utilization, i.e. make it there. This is an example experiment called ReLOX, and the idea is you can take lunar regolith, and if you have your right temperature and chemical conditions, then you can use solar-powered electrolysis to extract oxygen and hydrogen from moon rock. Should be fantastic, of course, because then you've got fuel to burn, you've got water to drink, you've got air to breathe. So this experiment is testing the particular electrolysis methods they're using would work in lunar gravity. As Martin said in the opening talk, we're going to want to be building stuff in space. 3D printing in zero gravity is quite hard. These guys had quite a nice approach. This is squirting a liquid polymer out of that nozzle and then has UV lights around to cure it in real time while they're extruding, so they can just draw 3D shapes in free space. This was printed in zero G. It was pretty good. This guy, his experiment had to be hidden inside the box, so you can't really see it, but they had inflatable tubes covered in polymer that was then cured, so you could make really big but rigid structures. And this is metal grains, and it could also use moon dust, metal grains that are sintered using heat to make them stick together. And these two spanners were actually printed in zero G. I was very impressed with the precision level there. So they're getting pretty good at it. They're quite small. You can see this screw head here for scale, but still, it's pretty good proof of concept. A lot of people are researching what you can do with electromagnetic fields for automated approach and docking, for example, for effects on boiling and evaporation and condensation processes, which sounds kind of boring fundamental physics, but they work so differently in zero G that it's really important to understand them for any kind of fluid control for chemical processes, for manufacture in space, and also for heat transfer for all of our electronic devices and things. Or even have a magnetic levitator facility on the ISS to get rid of all the vibrations from those pesky astronauts exercising. So you can float bits of molten metal inside our magnetic levitator, which is quite good fun. Talking of material science like that, metal alloys are a very interesting one. This is an alloy, think of aluminium and titanium, and you can see the titanium condenses out into these crystals, but they're different sizes and different shapes, and they're sedimentation, and they've all sunk, and then the surrounding fluid solidifies later. And that means that this bit of metal is not the same as that bit of metal, and that grain is not the same as that grain, all kinds of problems. That's what we're used to on Earth, that's what we've always lived with. You do it in zero G, you can have quite a different result. You can make entirely new metal alloys that wouldn't be able to really exist on Earth in a simple manner. So this is a furnace, it's actually for a sounding rocket, this one, 1500 degree furnace. That's the experiment module. As you saw, we just stack them on top of each other and put a pointy bit on to make a rocket. This is a related experiment that flew on parabolic flights. This is a good example of what I was saying with the dangerous ones, because we have a really hot furnace on here and a very powerful X-ray microscope that we've got around these people. So it was quite good fun trying to get that on board through all the safety regulations. But it worked very well. Here's a little video in zero G. You can see these crystals forming. There's no sedimentation. They get much, much, much larger. And it's not until the second fluid solidifies later. You just saw that wave go through there. Everything gets locked, but it's much more homogeneous, much bigger grains. It's literally a novel metal that you couldn't really make easily on Earth. never mind that one. We're going to run out of time otherwise. Sensors and dust and things, dust from comets and planetary nebula. We've seen a lot of this lately with the fantastic James Webb Space Telescope images, haven't we? One of the problems is that dust scatters light in really weird ways that we don't quite understand. So we get all these astronomical measurements and we go, that's very pretty, but what the hell is going on? So this experiment called Progrès 2, which stands for something in French, I don't know, has in this little sample holder different types of dust, like really, really specific grain sizes and grain types and grain shapes and densities and blah, 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 that float around in zero G. We scatter light through them and record the result and build a massive catalogue. This thing's flown actually, I think now dozens and dozens and dozens of times changing the samples to get a big catalogue. The idea being, we look up and go, "Ooh, that's very pretty. We've got a scattering pattern. What does that mean? What kind of dust is that? Oh, we've tried it. It's in our catalogue. It's that kind of dust." So it's very weird to me. I really like it that we end up testing stuff on parabolic flight that we go, "Ah, now we understand that astronomical observation from millions of light years away." I think that's fantastic. We're also looking at a lot of science on how protoplanetary disks form, on aggregation of dust particles into planetesimals, and the gas particle interactions. Got quite a lot of experiments on there that obviously you need zero G for, and it's quite hard to automate some of that stuff. So taking it on board parabolic flight is a really good option. But one of the benefits of the platform, as I said, is that we have humans on board, so we can research what happens to humans, because a lot of human physiology is really significantly affected by zero-G. I want to understand that. So testing neurocognition. This guy doesn't look like he's got a lot of neurocognition going on, but anyway. Spatial cognition, proprioception, understanding where your limbs are, even if you can't see them, that your ability to do that changes in zero G, which is quite interesting. Motion control, this experiment was great. These two boards that the guy's standing on will randomly and independently perturb his feet to try to make him stumble in reduced gravity, and then you're measuring his stumbling reactions to try and understand the kinematics of how humans will move around their reduced gravity environments. Obviously, he's got big straps, so he doesn't just fall over all the time. Cardiovascular stuff, your heart works very differently. This was a very interesting study. They found on some NASA astronauts that are in space long term that actually there's in some of the blood flow, it slows down so much because your system doesn't have to work so hard to pump your blood around your system. There's a particular part of the artery in your neck where in at least one astronaut they found blood flowing backwards, which is definitely not ideal. A clot had formed that could have gone somewhere and caused some problems and didn't, which is very good for him, of course. But then we had a study on parabolic flight going, okay, how is that a long-term effect, or can this happen very quickly? So they were doing ultrasound on this particular blood vessel during flight. And I think the results are published now, so I can say it happens quite quickly. That's something we need to be aware of, right? There's serious health concerns that we have to try and find countermeasures for. Ocular pressure changes. Long-term spaceflight can do funny things to your eyes. Some astronauts do have issues later on. These are my wonderfully kind colleagues who volunteered to wear stress-sensing contact lenses. They felt horrible, apparently, but they actually can change test in real time the changing pressure inside your eyeball. Your spine, as you know, probably changes shape and stiffness in zero-G, and that also happens very quickly. We have nice research on that, this medieval-looking torture device pushing into someone's spine. this was about bone growth, chondrocytes. Even like at that very small level that you'd think wouldn't really care about gravity, because it's just chemistry, right? Biochemistry. But it turns out chondrocytes really act very differently. So you have different rates of bone growth, and it's hard to stimulate them to make your bones grow in zero-G. Of course, it would be rather unethical to use human samples on this, so we use bovine samples, so it ends up with a beautiful mission patch from that experiment. That's kind of my overview of experiments with parabolic flights. Feel free to come and ask me later more detail about any of them or the other ones. I can talk for hours on it. As Graham mentioned, I don't only do parabolic flights. It's a bit more than half of my job. I'm still payload system engineer, like I have been since I started at ESA. My current projects I'm quite excited about, so I just wanted to mention them briefly. So back to this other diagram, I do actually do some work also here. I'm working on an experiment called negative ions on the lunar surface, being developed in Sweden, in Kiruna, and it should be flying with the Chinese Chang'e 6 spacecraft in 2024 to land on the far side of the moon, which is very nice. I've never sent anything above low Earth orbit before, so personally for me it's nice, but apparently the scientists are terribly excited about detecting negative ions on the surface of the moon, each to their own. I'm sure you've all heard of a Mars sample return. If not, there's a rover on Mars at the moment, Perseverance, that's taking rock core samples and just leaving them scattered around Mars and making litter all over Mars. And another NASA vehicle is going to go and pick them up. and an ascent vehicle is going to put them in orbit, and then an ESA spacecraft, the Earth Return Orbiter, is going to fly to Mars, rendezvous with this basketball-sized object in Martian orbit and bring it back to Earth. That will be the first spacecraft to ever do the return trip, to go to Mars and back. We've never needed that before, and for the first instance of that, it seems like a very good idea to measure the radiation environment, to characterize the radiation environment for future missions, for crewed missions, so we understand what it is. So for some reason I don't fully understand, I've been assigned to help develop this space dosimetry system payload that's going to go on board the Earth Return Orbiter and go to Mars and back. Those are my other projects at the moment. I'm also responsible, say, for Drop Tower, for human centrifuges. It's quite an eclectic range of stuff. It doesn't make any sense, sorry. It doesn't make sense to me either, but it's quite good fun. getting involved. The central access point for many of our platforms is at ideas.esa.int. You can go there. There's lots of different channels, lots of different things that people can apply for. Scientific proposals for the SciSpace program I talked about, which is the main framework I'm working in. They are welcome from academic institutes in any of the member states, and if they get selected on scientific merit, as I said, then ESA sponsors their flights. That's not just for parabolic flights, it's also for sounding rockets, for Drop Tower, for the ISS even. But at the moment I'm working on a new pilot phase for technology proposals for parabolic flights, so it doesn't have to be science. It could be testing deployment of antennas and solar panels. It could be raising technology readiness levels of devices that are going to space or to the moon or to Mars. So really technology focused instead of scientific focused, and from academic institutes in ESA member states, this can also be sponsored based on merit as long as it aligns with what ESA is trying to do. And another aspect of this new pilot phase is the idea to have commercial proposals. There's a lot of companies that want to do stuff in zero G, that need to do stuff in zero G, but they can't afford to go to space and they can't afford to fill the entire plane for themselves, to have a whole campaign for themselves. It's quite expensive. So the idea is we would just charge them at cost for them to have a relative portion of space and resources on ESA parabolic flights. They would have to pay for it, but a reasonable cost. So that it gives them access that they otherwise don't have. So this is the way I'm trying to expand access to ESA parabolic flights. And you never know, maybe if you have AMSAT technologies that are being developed in collaboration with universities, then the technology phase could work for applications. Or if you have particularly generous sponsors or find yourselves very flush, then we could go the commercial route. As I say, these are just pilot phases at the moment, so you can go to ideas.esa.int. You won't find these channels unless I invite you, but if you have a serious proposal to make soon, then contact me and I will invite you. That's fine. But if you're not in that much of a rush and you don't have anything yet, I hope that the pilot phases will finish in the next 6 months or so, and we'll open them officially in the middle of next year, so it can become a standard, continually open access route to parabolic flight. That's my idea. And then just to wrap up, I was recently at a couple of years ago now, I suppose, at a Star Trek convention giving an ESA talk, as you do, of course. And I've just stolen this slide from that because it was too good not to. Oh no. Get back. You didn't see that yet. Because they were asking, you know, when are we going to, this looks amazing, all these new technologies that you're researching, these new things you're developing, when are we going to have it? When are we going to have this Star Trek future? And I have to say we're doing it, but it takes small steps. And I've got the credits to Star Trek Enterprise here. So I think it exemplifies it really nicely. You start with the Wright Brothers flights and going to more and more complex aviation through the Apollo era, up to Mars rovers, etc. I think it's just a nice example of the progress of science, the steps that science and technology and these experiments are taking us on, one step at a time. We are boldly going, but it takes a long time to get there. So we're really, you know, looking towards a future. That's why we do it. I mean, myself, as I said at the convention, myself, a lot of my colleagues, and maybe some of you, were inspired by these kind of shows. That's why we're in it, because we're excited about that kind of future. Maybe not exactly that kind of future, but you know, a future that is brighter and better. for us all. So I suppose I just want to say it's a real privilege to be falling for the future. And I'm happy to take any questions. Firstly, to preempt, I know we're meant to be working on board. There is a little free-floating area at the back for if we have a few parabolas spare. This is a compilation of those spare parabolas. We don't just mess around, honest.
Right. Fantastic. Thank you so much. Questions from the floor, you invited. Okay. Oh, good. Okay. I'll talk up. Yeah, one question there.
What could be the significance of negative ions on the
moon? Could you repeat the question?
The question was, what would be the significance of negative ions on the moon? This is an excellent question. I would also love to know the answer. I'm not on the science team. I'm on the engineering team. I do have the documents. I can get back to you on that later on today. I'm going to have a look because I could try and explain it now, but this is being recorded and I don't want to get it wrong. Sorry.
Okay.
Well, I know I was very, very quick over lots of it.
Fantastic.
No questions, really? Yeah.
Neil, I guess these folks don't have any breakfast before they go on the
train. They absolutely do. Yeah, so you're worried about motion sickness, you mean?
Sorry, the question was about do they have breakfast before they go on this flight?
Well, yeah, no, it's a good question, and it's a question we're asked a lot, because, of course, we have to tell these people how to prepare. You should have breakfast because you don't want to be hypoglycemic. It is actually quite surprisingly hard work, especially if you're standing up during all the hypergravity like I do. You don't want to be low blood sugar because you'll pass out halfway through. So you do a breakfast, but have it a couple of hours beforehand at least, so it's not in your stomach anymore, it's moved on, so that reduces the risk. But also in motion sickness, a lot of people have heard the term vomit comet, etc. That's the NASA one, that's not us. But of course there is a big risk of motion sickness. If you didn't take any drugs at all and you just acted however you felt like, about half of the people would be too sick to work. That's a fact. But we give excellent drugs and excellent instruction. And then we've now got it down to less than 10%. We have 40 people on board. Maybe on flight one of a campaign, there'll be three or four people that are just a little bit sick, just for a parabola or two, and then come back to work. And the other days will be less. We've even had a couple of the third flights of a campaign where there was nobody sick at all. So we've developed over the years the right dosage, the right medication, and the right way to behave, particularly about keeping your head still in zero G, that it doesn't matter, you're not going to lose your breakfast. Most people are not going to lose their breakfast.
Fantastic detail, thank you. Any other questions from the room or anything on the stream?
Any more talk about throwing up just before lunch?
No, probably not good.
One from the stream.
Oh, yeah. Ah, an excellent question.
Could you repeat?
Oh, yes. So the question is, what are the stresses on board the A310-0G and how often does it have to be inspected and maintained? As you might imagine, there are stresses on it for the 1.8G phase, but actually, overall, they are well within inside the safety envelope of that aircraft. It's rated up to 2.4G or 2.5G, I believe. So everything it's doing is well within inside its safety envelope, so that's not a problem. In terms of the maintenance, of course, we do have to do more than normal. For a normal flight, like commercial plane, they count cycles. A cycle is one takeoff, one landing. And after a certain number of cycles, you inspect the wings for microfractures. After a certain number of cycles, you inspect the engines, etc. You have this maintenance schedule based on cycles. We do exactly the same with exactly the same numbers, but one cycle is a takeoff and landing, and each and every parabola. So on a flight with 31 parabolas, plus a takeoff and landing, we will do 32 times as much maintenance as a normal flight. So, but we're not changing the maintenance type, we're just changing the maintenance frequency. The 32 times is definitely very conservative. We tend to take it back to the shop, and the engineers open it up and go, why the hell have you come back here? This still looks brand new. What are you doing? So we know it's very conservative, and we have Nova Space have a perfect safety record. So. Good question. Thank you.
Okay. No other questions? Thank you very much indeed again, Neil. A wonderful presentation. as I was expecting and hoping, perfectly politically correct at every point. So, well done there. Thank you again. Another round of applause.
Very welcome. Thank you.